Okay, Bergson and the Holographic Theory of Mind. Ongoing series, part 46, Intuition and the Wasp, or Intuition and the Wasp and Evolution. So we'll be looking at certain types of knowledge that wasps present that are inexplicable from an evolutionary point of view. And what we're going to see is that instinct is the same as form, the same problem, the same organic structure problem resides in the instinct problem, same evolutionary problem. And we'll be looking at why the intellect, our intellect, has a very limited power, in fact, is incapable in and of itself of penetrating this form of knowledge or evolutionary problem itself. And of course, we'll see why in its origins, the very nature and origin of intellect. To penetrate instinct, we're going to come to sympathy, which is itself a form of instinct or intuition. How the wasps do this, and how we're going to have to do this. The remarkable thesis of Bergson, that is, we're requiring a new level of human evolution, a new higher form of knowledge. So that's what we'll be looking at. So intuition. Bergson is perhaps most famous for his emphasis on this concept, intuition. Everyone kind of knows, understands, experiences it. But as usual with Bergson, it is highly doubtful this concept is actually understood with its radical implications for our science, indeed for the evolution of human consciousness. The concept, intuition, was developed in the context of evolution. That is, how is evolution explained? What is the mechanism for evolution? Thus, in the analysis of Darwin and Neo-Darwinism. It's the salient feature in Creative Evolution of 1907. Now, in what's following, one should be mindful of, keep in mind, that Bergson is not an intelligent design guy. We're going to see things that look like this, but he is not. He considered it finalism, just the inverse of mechanism. Mechanism deterministically evolves things, brings things to a construction. Finalism is just the inverse. That is, it's drawing something being created to itself, to an idea. So this is all discussed a bit in number seven, but in number seven really should be considered a very important adjunct to this one we're going to go into. So we're about to try to penetrate this concept, intuition. We're going to go immediately to what, in my opinion, is a pivotal point in creative evolution. Bergson begins here in the problem of the hymenoptera. Yes, the wasp and sawflies, bees, ants. Females, according to Wiki, in Hymenoptera, typically insert their eggs in host. Okay, so probably not a problem for evolutionary theory. So here's Bergson. We know that the different species of Hymenoptera that have this paralyzing instinct lay their eggs in spiders, beetles, or caterpillars, which, having first been subjected by the wasp to a skillful surgical operation, will go on living motionless a certain number of days and thus provide the larvae with fresh meat. Nice. And in the sting, which they give to the nerve centers of their victims in order to destroy its power of moving without killing it, these different species of Hymenoptera take into account, so to speak, the different species of prey they respectively attack. Continuing, the scolia, which attacks the larvae of a rose beetle, stings it in one point only. But in this point, the motor ganglia are concentrated. In those ganglia alone, that is just the motor ganglia, the stinging of other ganglia might cause death and putrefaction, which it must avoid, so its little ones can eat. The yellow-winged spex, which has chosen the cricket for its victim, knows that the cricket has three different nerve centers which serve its three pairs of legs, or at least acts as if it knew this. It stings the insect first under the neck, then behind the prothorax, and then where the thorax joins the abdomen. Continuing, the Haemophila, Hirsuta, gives nine successive strokes of its sting upon the nine nerve centers of its caterpillar, and then seizes the head and squeezes it in its mandibles, enough to cause paralysis without death. How can we account for this knowledge by evolutionary steps? Neo-Darwinism gives us random mutations carried by DNA if the mutation has survival value. But one asks then, well, did an Ammophila once learn all nine strokes and transmitted it in its DNA? Remember, just one stroke is no good. It doesn't actually paralyze the caterpillar. You need all nine plus the head thingy with the mandibles. You need all nine because by definition, it can't be selected unless there's survival value. How are these wasps providing for their offspring before this knowledge arrived? How are the larvae staying alive before this knowledge? Think about the significance of that question. In other words, it's a question how they ever learned it, quote unquote, at all before they simply started to exist. There is a new synthesis position in evolution. This adds self-organization to Darwinism. So you have self-assembly, where you have chemical molecular structures self-building, building themselves via forces, such as in the pictures up there, where we have molecules assembling into a geometrical structure, various geometrical structures. There's self-organization per se, which is the self-creation of structures where we're employing constant energy input, known as dissipative structures, as per Ilya Prigogine. So you require energy input, like to build a cell, to maintain the structure. But how does a system, an organism such as our wasp, self-organize into this knowledge, the exact 3 points to sting a cricket, the exact 9 points to sting a caterpillar, plus don't forget the nice head squeeze, the precise location of the critical knot of motor neurons? And note, this knowledge implies the structures already, the stinger, the ovipositor, the muscular support, all that's involved in that highly complex structure, and the functionality required to support the act implementing this knowledge. So the problem seems inverted. That is, the function, the idea, we'll call it, the behavior, the stinging to paralyze the wasp such that it's still alive, so it serves as nice food for your children, precedes the structure, as the structure is oriented toward the behavior. So the idea, the concept of what's got to be done seems to come first. We're not simply self-organizing or via mutation creating new structures. For example, like ovipositors, which beings like wasps then discover are useful for stinging caterpillars. We already have to account for the idea, shall we say, of the function itself, the behavior, the intended actions, or as Bergson will better term it, the impetus. That is to say, we are dealing with the problem of consciousness, the consciousness behind evolution, the impetus behind evolution. For Bergson, consciousness is the impetus of evolution. It is for this reason that our intellect by itself cannot penetrate the wasp, its origin of its instinct, the origin of its structure. And our intellect is the foundation of science, the very tool by which our science proceeds. So we're going to be looking at the origin of this limitation. Why? It's what we're about to see. But a couple related things first. So related one, the mousetrap. That is the problem of common sense knowledge, which we dealt with extensively in number 7. The 9 stings necessary for paralyzing the caterpillar, the 3 stings at precise points for the cricket. Of what does this remind us? Irreducible complexity and the mousetrap, a concept made famous by Behe in 1996. One cannot evolve or mutate by a series of mutations just one part of the mousetrap, or the wasp, so to speak, by itself having no survival value. Or if transitioning from trap A to trap B, so we've got a trap here, remember the trap is simply a metaphor for a complex biological structure. If we make a change to trap A, or trap 5 up there, which leaves it non-functional until we get to trap B, we can't just do that. We need the entirety at once. Notice we're going from trap, revolving from trap 5 to trap 6, a more complex trap. We need an interrelated set of parts that create a functional whole. Notice the transformation steps here to move from trap 5 to trap 6. We've got to expand the platform, reposition the spring on the platform, rotate the hammer down, create a slot to hold that hold down bar in the front of the platform there. Position the hold down very precisely, create a fancy release for the hold down so the hammer slams down on the mouse. So again, we need all of these things to happen at once. Until then, trap 5 is not a functional trap, it's not trap 6. So in number 7, I noted evolutionists in treating this problem have simply bumbled with no awareness apparently into the massively unsolved problem of AI, common sense knowledge. They think that AI and artificial intelligence programs can do this, but this is clearly common sense knowledge. We saw that in creating a mousetrap out of a pile of components, pencil box, string, rubber bands, paper clips, cheese, mouse, razor blade, etc. Perhaps we create a crossbow-like mousetrap or a mini beheader. This requires transformations carried out over an indivisible time, transformations which preserve invariance laws, dynamic transformations of imagery. For example, we're talking the non-computational thought of a Penrose, or we're stacking those cubes one by one, or those little three-sided cubes one by one to make an ever larger cubical number. Transformations where we're preserving invariance over each stacking. And we saw that this requires a device far beyond a standard computer, a device based in Bergson's model of the brain slash mind. And that if the universe is capable of creating such contraptions as beetles, butterflies, brontosaurs, it is a far different device from a cosmic computer or a cosmic AI device. Yet the evolutionist and AI are allies. Evolutionists implicitly, covertly appeal to AI-like processes. They have no clue the problem they're facing. Then there was number 26, the memory of spiders. Here we saw the unreal complexity in spiderweb construction, or bird migration, etc. And again, just like the wasp, the question became, how can DNA possibly code such knowledge? We began exploring the possibility of morphic fields, a la Sheldrake, also in number 43. But these fields might explain the memory passed from generation of spider to generation, but not the initial creation. There was, as we talked about, spider number one, who knows how to create webs right off the bat, otherwise he dies. Or wasp number one, same problem. We're forced to the beginning, to consciousness. If there is a deepest theme in creative evolution, it is consciousness is the impetus behind the explosion of forms. My suspicion, the role of consciousness in creative evolution is considered interesting, or maybe was considered interesting. It does not carry close to the weight it should. Why? Because matter and memory is not understood. And matter and memory is the foundation of creative evolution. As we've seen in this series, no one understood matter and memory because it was a holographic theory 50 years before the invention of holography by Gabor. In creative evolution, it's amazing how minimal is Bergson's application of his matter and memory model of consciousness and perception. Barely a, quote, I said stuff on this in another work type of thing. But it was the solution to the hard problem before the hard problem was understood. And the hard problem is still not understood. But this hard problem is the key, the salient problem of our times. It just wasn't known as such in the time of creative evolution in 1907. Suppose the hard problem and Bergson were really grasped and accepted. Do we not think that creative evolution would be weighed far more seriously? This is the problem. But if consciousness is merely an epiphenomenon, a mirror, to quote Bergson, phosphorescence from the brain, as he noted in creative evolution, all is just matter. And consciousness, just being a phosphorescence, an emanation, an emergence from the brain, cannot be the impetus of evolution. It's just an epiphenomenon. Rather, it's just a result. But this concept is changing. For Bergson's solution to the hard problem, his matter and memory model of individual conscious perception absolutely spills over into, requires, implies that larger consciousness impelling evolution, what he might call superconsciousness. We've seen it many times. The barest review here, the universal field regarded as a holographic field. In matter and memory, the key phrase being the photograph already developed in the very heart of things and at every point of space. The brain, in essence, a modulated reconstructive wave passing through this field. Again, modulated reconstructive wave and the reconstructive wave process. We take a frequency of reconstructive wave passing through the holographic plate on which a wave front of an original source has been recorded and specified now as the wavefront of the source associated with frequency one, a cube. If I modulate to frequency two, I'll get the sources of the wavefront associated with frequency two, the wine glass. Modulate to frequency three, I'll get the source associated with frequency three, the cup. Back to frequency one, back to the cube. So the brain is passing through this field, supporting, as it were, creating a reconstructive wave, specifying a source within the field, say the coffee cup on the table, and at a scale of time determined by the brain's dynamics, its underlying chemical velocity. So a fly in normal scale buzzing by the coffee cup, but change the dynamics underlying that reconstructive wave, increase the frequencies or the velocity processes, it might look like a heron flapping its wings. At another scale, like a cloud of electrons. Specifications to the past, to past portions of the field's transformation. How is this possible? How can the specification be to the past? Because the transformation of this holographic field is indivisible. There are no discrete instants. For each past instant falls into the past, the non-existence as a present instant arrives. Rather, the field is 4D in extent. And this is the kicker, where we meet that larger, that cosmic scale consciousness, the superconsciousness behind evolution. For the transforming holographic field must carry elementary attributes of consciousness, an elementary awareness via its holographic property. For the state of each point, so to speak, in the field reflects that the state of every other point. So there's an elementary awareness, so to speak, at each point of the whole, and an elementary memory via its indivisible transformation. Each moment reflects the history of the whole. The field is 4D. Thus, the specification is to a time-scaled form of the elementary awareness defined over the field, be it buzzing fly, heron-like fly, or ensemble of electrons like fly. Subject differentiates from object in terms of time then, not space, because there are no distinct objects in this field. The they're practically distinct, but the precise outlines we give these objects do not actually exist. The whole field fades into itself, shall we say, as one field. So at the null scale of time, our body has no sharp differentiation spatially from the field. So all of this then is removing the homunculus up there that would be behind the specified wavefront observing the object. There is no homunculus. The specification is to time scaled awareness of the field. This is the profound relation of subject and object in Bergson's model. So our individual consciousness is a flowing aspect of that larger flowing consciousness defined over the field, the consciousness defined over the ever-transforming field. So already in matter and memory, we see that consciousness, cosmic scale, that Bergson sees as the impetus behind evolution, the force behind it, the force behind the knowledge, the instinct of the wasp. The formation of the wasp is an organic structure as well. So both the force behind both the instinct and the structure. So why is our intellect incapable of understanding this process, this knowledge, the instinct, the organic formation thereof? What is the nature and origin of intellect? It already starts in the model of perception. The holographic field is a vast field of information. It is a vast sea of action, motions flowing everywhere. To quote Bergson, any given object in that field is obliged, quote, to transmit the whole of what it receives, to oppose every action with an equal and contrary reaction, to be, in short, merely the road by which pass in every direction the modifications, or what can be termed real actions, propagated throughout the immensity of the entire universe. So what is the principle for the selection of a subset of this information and its specification as an image? It is that information that the body can act upon, that is, it is referenceable to the body's capability for action. Thus, for Bergson, perception is virtual action. From this undifferentiated transforming field, our body's first order of business as a child, a baby, is to carve out bodies in which it can act, to hold a baby bottle, to shake or rattle. Thus begins the partition of the field into objects and their motions. And this partition gets ever more rarefied. Beneath and through the surrounding field, we place a mesh, as it were, as Bergson noted in Matter and Memory. The meshes are made ever smaller conceptually. We end with the continuum of points or positions, the theoretical continuum. And motion is now treated as simply a series of points in the static continuum. I move the cup across the continuum, and it's treated as a trajectory, a line of points, point after point after point. This, of course, is an infinite regress, because between each pair of points on that red line of points, we must reintroduce the motion. So we have line after line of points, each being broken down into further points, and we never get to the true motion. Motion slips through the cracks in this treatment. Each point, however, corresponds to an instant of time. So time is simply the fourth dimension of this abstract space, the series of static instants. Each instant, each point on the motion is essentially then corresponding to a block of the all of space, which, where each block has an zero extent of time. It's a static block. And each is utterly stripped of quality, homogeneous. So we get block after block of space, and this is the fourth dimension of time, a four-dimensional structure of three-dimensional blocks of space, solids. This is the classic metaphysic. This is the playground of our intellect. All our science, all our math, our calculus, based upon it. And it all started with solids, with perception, parsing those objects upon which we can act. To quote, let us start then from action and lay down the intellect, lay down that intellect aims, first of all, at constructing. This fabrication or construction is exercised exclusively on inert matter, and of inert matter itself, fabrication deals only with the solid. The rest escapes by its very fluidity. Continuing, if therefore the tendency of the intellect is to fabricate, we may expect to find that whatever is fluid in the real will escape it in part, and whatever is life in the living will escape it altogether. Our intelligence, as it leaves the hands of nature, has for its chief object the unorganized solid. Unorganized as opposed to organic, living matter. So stay tuned here. To the intellect, we are surrounded by a material field, extended. Objects absolutely distinct, external to other objects. Parts external to parts. Each part infinitely divisible. The entire field, the continuum, infinitely divisible, all treated as units. The objects, solids, are certainly mobile, but for the motion itself, the intellect turns away. To quote, but the intellect is meant for something altogether different. Unless it does violence to itself, it takes the opposite course. It always starts with immobility, as if this were the ultimate reality. When it tries to form an idea of movement, it does so by constructing movement out of immobilities put together. Again, we move the cup and we reconstruct it as a series of immobilities. Of immobility alone does the intellect form a clear idea. This homogeneous, empty medium, infinitely divisible, lends itself to any mode of decomposition. The space is therefore preeminently the plan of our possible action upon things. The intellect is characterized by the unlimited power of decomposing according to any law, and it does so by constructing movement out of immobilities put together. And Bergson would note motion treated as a series of immobilities is an absurdity, but that's the classic metaphysic. The symbols we use in language, logic, are themselves derived from solids. Behold the Pythagorean theorem there. Derived from solids, a squared plus b squared equals c squared. As these symbols are derived from the consideration of solids, as the rules for combining these symbols hardly do more than express the most general relations among solids, our logic triumphs in that science which takes the solidity of bodies for its object, geometry. Another, the quadratic equation, an expression of solids. Intellect behaves as if fascinated by inert matter. Hence its bewilderment when it turns to the living and is confronted with organization. And just as it fixes in things in space, it fixes in time. It cannot deal with pure mobility. Again, we have the series of static instants. The actual motion is lost. This framework rejects creativity. All is the recomposition of static elements, or the already old. To quote, the intellect is characterized by a natural inability to comprehend life. So how is it going to comprehend instinct? The intellect is an aspect, a cutout of a larger whole. The reconstructive way there is a specification of an aspect of the whole, itself within the whole. Therefore, it cannot be that which comprehends this whole. Think about that. Instinct, on the contrary, is molded on the very form of life. While intelligence treats everything mechanically, instinct proceeds, so to speak, organically. For the consciousness driving it only carries out further the work by which life organizes matter, so that we cannot say where organization, that is the organization of structure like the wasp itself, and instinct begins. See, there's no precise dividing line. There isn't one. There's no dividing line between the structure, chunk of that wasp that does the depositing of the eggs and the stinging, and the knowledge that allows it to paralyze that caterpillar. Remember, how is this organic structure of the wasp separate from the concept of the action the instinct will be performing? So Bergson says the most essential of the primary instincts are really, therefore, vital processes. There's no differentiation. The cells of our body, you know, it's all working for a common end, yet each living for itself, each cell preserving itself, reproducing itself. Like so many instincts, each cell is instinctual. The bees in a hive, each bee is like a cell, united by an indivisible bond. A bee separated, even given food and water, dies. The instinct that animates the bee is indistinguishable from the force that animates a cell. Here, instinct coincides with organization, that is, organizing matter, or the organization of structure in matter, such as the wasp stinger. Thus, the instinctive knowledge that one species possesses of another on a particular point, that is, the wasp or the caterpillar or the cricket, has its root in the very unity of life, a whole sympathetic unto itself. Instinct and intellect are two divergent lines of evolution. Intelligence, fluid composition, decomposition of inert matter. Instinct within itself, totally embedded in the concrete, in the organic. Reception is an example. The intellect asks, how is it that we see the cone out there, the ice cream cone on the right? We understand touching the cup, the coffee cup, or the ice cream cone, the light hitting the retina. It's like a touch. But seeing the cone at a distance out there literally is action at a distance. And what he's referring to here is the problem that Newton had with his law of gravitation. It seemed to him abhorrent, inexplicable action at a distance. To him, his whole theory of gravitation was yet ungrounded. It seemed magic. How is that attractive force actually working? So starting with the light touching the retina, our intellect begins constructing mechanisms, logic, computer programs, neural nets to affect this seeing of the cone out there at a distance. But all of this is inside the brain or the computer. Witness AI and self-seeing, self-driving cars, Elon Musk, etc., etc. So all takes place in the computer. The cone, I put it in quotes, is in the computer. Not like it looked, that it looks like that in the computer. It's a pile of bits. And doesn't even look like bits for that matter. So action at a distance, not solved. The cone's still out there. And in there. Haven't solved the action at a distance problem. Bergson simply says here in Creative Evolution, but we have shown elsewhere that the philosophical explanation of perception must be of another kind. And we see what he is so vaguely referring to, the holographic reconstructive wave model of matter and memory. Again, there is no cone inside the brain or inside the computer. The cone is right where it says it is, external within the field. It's being specified as such. Action at a distance, solved. So we know what this massively, quote, of another kind means. And as you think about it, the elegance of this model is one heck of an intuition, especially before any invention of holography. So noting that quote again, the role of sympathy, whole sympathetic unto itself. We're going to hit that now. So how does the wasp solve the construction of this instinctive behavior, the 9 points of the caterpillar? It does so by sympathy, a sympathy between the wasp and its victim, which teaches the wasp from within the caterpillar's vulnerability. From within, this feeling of vulnerability might owe nothing to outward perception, but result from the mere presence together of the ammophila with the caterpillar, considered no longer as two organisms, but as two activities. Remember, they're all in the field, one field, no precise differentiation. Instinct is not resolvable in terms of intelligent elements, or even in terms necessarily intelligible, but it is not beyond the limits of mind. Instinct is sympathy. It is oneness with life, union with other beings, with all being. Intelligence dwells on the surface of life with its objects, the infinity and fluidity of their relations. To quote, but it is to the very inwardness of life that intuition leads us. By intuition, I mean instinct that becomes disinterested, self-conscious, capable of reflecting on its object and enlarging it indefinitely, unquote. But Bergson is saying, to take our science to another stage, to penetrate the instinct, that is the mysterious intelligence of the wasp, to penetrate the evolution's formation of the organic structure of the wasp. Remember, there's no differentiation between these two. Humanity itself must move to a new evolutionary stage. Pure intellect alone is a dead end stage of one evolutionary line. Humanity and science must move to intellect guided by intuition. To me, one route to greater understanding of what Bergson means lies in certain meditation practices, where one simply contemplates intently a certain object, say a rose, a tree. And what one finds in this kind of literature is that one becomes one eventually with the tree. The sap, you are the tree, the sap is flowing through you, you are the tree processes. One can find some of these types of meditations described in this little book, for example, Strange as It May Seem. And of course, there's lots of other literature involving this. But when it comes to a scientific theory, Bergson is certainly asking for far more than I've ever seen described. Remember, one is trying to penetrate processes and then have to describe these using the intellect. If there was one example, it would certainly be Bergson's own model of perception, as we've seen. Once you understand it, you can only stand back in complete awe. In his brief descriptions of how life might form a being or an eye, one says, wow, to go further, deeper, more detailed, this would take one heck of an intuitive absorption. Let me give a very brief idea of what I mean here. Let's consider making eyes, evolution's making of our eyes, or crab eyes, or spider eyes. The eye is massively complex. To quote Bergson, an infinity of mechanisms. On the right there, we see just some of the parts of the eye. It can be far worse, a more fine subdivision. This can keep on going. Now, mechanism. Remember, we noted mechanism versus finalism at the beginning. Mechanism attempts to explain the putting of all these parts, quote unquote, together, gradually, by chance, mutations, but with no ability to explain their correlation, their actual organization. That's left to magic. There's no explanation for that. Finalism sees all the parts brought together by a preconceived plan. Like a workman constructing a watch, the idea, the concept is drawing all the parts together into the final form. Per Bergson, we have to move beyond both. Life does not proceed by the association and addition of elements, but by dissociation and division. Note, he says, the extreme contrast, the simplicity of vision, the complexity of the eye. This complexity, he says, may only be the simple act of vision, the act of vision divided for us into a mosaic of cells, whose order seems marvelous to us because we have conceived the whole as an assemblage of all those parts. Nature, he says, has had no more trouble in making an eye than I have lifting my hand. Nature's simple act has divided itself automatically into an infinity of elements. Again, stop for a second. On the left there, again, the classic metaphysic. We move my hand from A to B, just as we move the cup before. And we describe it as a trajectory of an infinity of points. In actuality, it's an indivisible motion, which the intellect describes as an infinity of points. So an infinity of elements, which are then found to be coordinated after the fact into one idea, just as the indivisible movement of my hand has dropped an infinity of points, as far as the intellect is concerned, which are then found to satisfy one equation. So it is this division of creation of eyes or mousetraps that our intuition must penetrate. So to return to making mousetraps, that is a problem where at least we're conceptualizing that maybe we have a pool of parts to start from. In looking at the literature of the new synthesis, or the extended synthesis or something, I'm not exactly sure what the new position is truly described as. I ran across Stuart Kauffman, an article, Evolution Beyond Entailing Law, Information and Self-Organization, in the book below there by Marx et al. On biological information. Now, Stuart has, in some ways, a very Bergsonian perspective. For example, he says, no law entails the evolution of the biosphere. That is, we're not going to be able to actually describe laws fitting evolution for the creation of forms. And one key to this, as he writes, is this. The deep importance is this. We cannot name all the causal consequences or uses of any object, say a screwdriver, alone or with other objects. The set of uses appears to be both unbounded or indefinite and unorderable. But that means we cannot know that we have ever listed all the uses of a screwdriver alone or with other objects or processes. Now, again, this looks very much like, in fact, it is, the common sense knowledge problem that I described that afflicts AI in the creation of mousetraps from components. Remember in number seven, I noted for AI programs, at least the one I was looking at, the problem began with this. In a problem in a database for a pencil, list all the possible functions. If you're claiming that it's just matching functions to functions, well, can you list all the possible functions? And the answer is going to be no. He adds, now consider an evolving cell in which one or more objects or processes, each with myriad causal consequences, finds a novel use that we cannot pre-state, but which enhances the fitness of the cell, and so is grafted by natural selection into the evolving biosphere. This finding of a novel use that we cannot pre-state occurs all the time. The famous flagellar motor of some bacteria made use, again, a flagellar motor, via Darwinian pre-adaptions or exceptations, it's going to discuss below, of fragments of its flagellar proteins that were serving entirely different functions in other bacteria. So the flagellar motor was an analog of the mousetrap, that where we use various components to create mousetraps or new kinds of mousetraps. Now, exceptation that he points to there, but this and other names was precisely what the evolutionists, Kevin Miller, Daniel Dennett, Shermer, Dawkins, all use, just use other names, generate and test, co-opt, various names, to implicitly form or appeal to a form of cosmic AI program, as though they solve the problem of common sense knowledge. So Kauffman has to be saying that exceptation is nothing like AI and requires an entirely different form of device. But unfortunately, he says all this is affected by natural selection. It's not possible. We're back to the problem of irreducible complexity. The mousetrap must have all the parts to be functional and selected, and the wasp must know all the places to sting the cricket. So Stewart thinks natural selection still works, is operative, and irreducible complexity is not a problem. Why B, not a problem? Well, irreducible complexity guys, or intelligent design guys, argue via the massive improbability of natural selection selecting all the changes simultaneously again. But Kauffman argues, given there's no law of evolution and all the unforeseen uses of parts, probabilities can no longer be computed. We don't know the space. This is an easy escape route from the intelligent design or irreducible complexity argument. It's just too easy. Examples are easy where it's mathematically fixed. In the case of proteins, we know the space. There are 20 amino acids. They can be joined in, say, 20 to the 35th ways that will give a string that is 35 amino acids long, a peptide. There isn't any question as to what the space is. Again, remember, we've got all of these things. So you can't state all the uses of a part, yes, but you can make a huge finite list for each, say the pencil, a punji stake, a spear, an axe handle, pillar support, fire, a fuel, or a writing instrument, et cetera, et cetera. And you can assign probabilities of use. I mean, if I got 25 uses, the probability is 1 out of 25. And then you can quickly get the massive joint improbability of selecting the correct uses for the combination you need, right? Given all the other parts, 1/25 times 140, 1 over 42, et cetera, et cetera. But this is only the beginning of the problem, as I noted in number 7. You can't predefine the features of an object either, nor the set of possible transformations under which the features emerge. So not only can you not list all the possible functions, if you try to make it more primitive to the features of an object, you still set, that's impossible because they emerge under transformation. So you can't define those either. So Kauffman is trying to save natural selection as the mechanism for evolution. It's a lost cause. The unforeseen uses of parts by evolution, yes, okay. But he's missing the far larger implications Bergson explored in creative evolution. To quote, if after the fact we could know these causes in detail, we could explain them by the form that has been produced. Foreseeing the form is out of the question. But causality is a creature of the classic metaphysic. To quote, such is the case with astronomical, physical, and chemical facts, with facts which form part of a system in which elements supposed to be unchanging and merely put together, in which the only changes are changes of position, in which there is no theoretical absurdity in imagining that things are restored to their place, in which consequently the same elementary phenomenon can be repeated. Again, what he's talking about there, a good example is the billiard balls, right? We imagine applying the same forces, the same vector, the same billiard ball, and we get the same path into the ball over and over, according to a law. But none of these are actually the same from time to time. The balls are not the same, the forces are not the same, only practically the same. Nothing truly repeats. All is at a practical level, exalted, however, to a metaphysical dogma. And, but against this idea of the absolute originality and foreseeability of forms, our whole intellect arises in revolt. For science, the epitome of intellect, quote, in dealing with things, science is only concerned with the aspect of repetition. Though the whole be original, science will always manage to analyze it into elements or aspects that are absolutely a reproduction of the past. Thus, what you see, or what you call an unforeseeable form for science, as they would say, is only an arrangement of old elements. But this is only possible in the abstract space and the abstract time, just another dimension of this space of the classic metaphysic. An absolutely homogeneous, perfectly repeatable continuum. And this metaphysic is the child of the intellect. And this intellect is only a cutout, an aspect of the transforming whole. And this transforming whole is psychical. As Bergson noted, the impetus driving evolution is but a metaphor or an image. It is the essence of the psychical to unfold a confused plurality of interpenetrating terms. Only in abstract space is distinct multiplicity possible. Now, he deals a lot about this with the creative of, in Time and Free Will. That is, in the mind, none of these things we think are distinct objects. Ideas are in fact distinct. But what is psychical cannot entirely correspond with space, that is abstract space, that is with externality of the apples or any other point in space, nor enter perfectly into categories of understanding. For a true science of evolution, we return to this requirement, a higher union of the two evolutionary lines of instinct, of intellect. Yes, to what must become the guide of our intelligence and our science, to intuition. Creative evolution, in my opinion, is the most profound philosophical work ever written. Now, I know that's saying a lot. There's a huge amount in there that could be unpacked. I haven't even tried, even begun. It's just too deep, too much. Yes, it is self-contained, but only somewhat. Matter and memory, time and free will, extremely important supports, as we've sort of seen. Again, in my humble opinion, our set of current philosophers, staying in the Hymenoptera theme, comparatively intellectual acts, ants. Bergson is either buried, take this as an example, Creative Evolution by Amit Goswami, 2008. Here's a quote, one little quote, Ray Bergson. In the 19th century, the vital body played an essential part in biological thinking. For example, the much admired philosopher Henry Bergson, 1949, saw life as an expression of the élan vital, or vital essence. The special feel of life from the inside, what we today call vital energy. Now, 1949 references to Bergson's book, Introduction to Metaphysics, nothing to do with creative evolution. And this quote is probably the most abject underestimation of Bergson's philosophy that one could find. I mean, we've seen nothing about the vital body and the vital essence. Just from what we've seen here, this utterly misses the mark. Amit clearly did not look at creative evolution. And of course, one could ask, why wouldn't you find other, this is the only quote, only mention of Bergson here, some explanation of why you've stolen the creative evolution title. Remember, we're dealing with a book that appeared in 1907, for which Bergson became such a celebrity that the ladies of Paris wanted him to give his lectures in the Paris Opera Hall so they could hold all the people that wanted to hear him. And the French army took the élan vital as their theme in the World War I as their theme. So you would expect a little more, but not. Now, both Goswami and Kauffman, who we've seen, used the quantum measurement woo, that is the collapse, which supposedly has something to do with consciousness in the Copenhagen framework, to anchor the theories of evolution as driven by consciousness. Again, this is why the real nature of the measurement problem must be understood. The measurement problem actually goes away. But when you've got the measurement Copenhagen framework, you can explain just about anything, and Amit Goswami is very good at that. So Bergson's either buried or beyond them, or there's just too much arrogance with respect to their own intellect. I really don't know which. It's just a strange phenomenon of the times. I'd add here, There's another inversion, interesting. The presumption is currently that all must start from physics. It's from this basis that we'll explain consciousness, explain evolution. Kauffman and Goswami start from the quantum mechanical collapse slash consciousness to explain evolution. But there is one solution to the hard problem, and that's Bergson's. Once one understands the hard problem, that is, remember Chalmers, as I noted, is a misdirection. And this solution requires a holographic universal field. We have seen the measurement problem is an ontology problem. And Bohm's pilot wave is the best looking solution to the ontology problem. Once you realize that special relativity has no status whatsoever as a block. And here the collapse is gone, therefore the woo. And Bohm is a holographic model of the universal field. So this is the inverse direction. Bergson's model of perception, let it become the working hypothesis. Physics try to verify Bohm's pilot wave and his holographic model. Then we'd have the framework for neuroscience to instantiate Bergson's model, the brain as a reconstructive wave. Then, what does this mean for evolution? At this point, that's my view. So next we'll see. Till then, signing off.